Welcome. I am Amalia Chamorro. I'm the Associate Director of Education Policy at UnidosUS, the largest Hispanic civil rights advocacy organization in the U.S. We are proud of our expansive networks of over 270 affiliates, organizations. These are Latino-led organizations across the U.S. and Puerto Rico that are deeply committed to empowering and driving meaningful change in their communities. And programs we have established, like the National Institute for Latino School Leaders, that prepare leaders to become well-equipped advocates. And we have some of our NISL fellows here today, our current cohort, as well as some alums. Yeah, shout out. All right. And for more than 50 years, Unidos has united communities seeking common ground through collaboration and the shared desire to make our country stronger. UnidosUS advocates for inclusive schools where all children are welcome and their constitutional rights to our public education are upheld. The current trajectory of U.S. immigration policy threatens to undercut the long-term outcomes for nearly 6 million U.S. children who are at risk of being separated from their undocumented parents or caretakers, most of whom are Latinos. The stress of current U.S. immigration policy and political discourse serve as negative multipliers to pre-existing social, economic, and health inequities. Thank you for joining us today to discuss this very important topic about how the real impact of U.S. immigration policies are reaping such dire outcomes on school environments, educators, and their students. So before we get started, and I introduce our moderator for the panel, I just want to share with you one of our resources. And some of you have postcards that say progress report that we've been passing out in the rows. That is our education blog platform, where we have articles, tools, and resources. How does it work? All right. So this is progress report. It's our education news platform. The website is progressreport.co, and we have policy analysis, reports, videos. It's really a multimedia platform that we want to make available and accessible to everyone. And we have a resources tab at the top where you will actually find an electronic copy of the report that we are releasing today, which my colleague Emily will go over in terms of findings for that report. And as you can see, we have both content in Spanish and English. These are not only resources for educators, but also for community. This is just to give you an example. So with that, I want to introduce our moderator, Delia Pompa. Ms. Delia Pompa will provide remarks and moderate the panel. She has dedicated her career to the principles of education equity and justice, having worn many hats as a bilingual classroom educator to serving as the Migration Policy Institute's Senior Fellow for Education Policy on the National Center on Immigrant Integration Policy team. In this capacity, Delia's work has focused on research and policy analysis related to improving educational services for immigrant students and English learners. Ms. Pompa came to MPI from UnidosUS, so she's always been part of La Familia, as we call it, where she served as Senior Vice President for Programs, overseeing its education, health, housing, workforce development, and immigrant integration work, so a lot. She handled a lot of work. She has had a key role in shaping federal education policy through her position as Director of the Office of Bilingual Education and Minority Language Affairs in the U.S. Department of Education, and as Executive Director of the National Association for Bilingual Education, NABE. Her career and leadership are a reminder to all of us about the power of advocacy to improve lives. Please join me in welcoming Ms. Delia Pompa.
Thank you.
And here's one of you.
All right, great. Morning, everyone. It is a real honor to be here as an alumnus and as someone who still follows the work of Unidos and relies on Unidos for their work. This report today is seminal in a lot of ways. It's important to hear about right now, and it captures a reality that we often don't think about. A generation at risk. The title alone captures a reality that we don't think about, and that's the number of children in our schools and in our country who either are immigrants themselves or have at least one parent who's an immigrant. 18 million children at the latest count fit that category. They had at least one parent who's an immigrant. That means they might have two. They themselves might be immigrants. So the discourse we're talking about, the realities of policy that we're talking about, affect them greatly and affect them every day. Why are they at risk? Why is this generation at risk? I think we need to remember when we're talking about children that this is a critical period in their life. It's a period when their social, their cultural, their political identities are being formed. And when they hear about the policies, and when they hear the discourse, when they turn on their TV and hear an important person in government talking about how they're a threat to this country, when they go down the street and hear that a neighbor has gone away and was deported to Mexico, to Honduras, to someplace, those identities that are being formed take a new shape. They change in very important ways. And so this generation is at risk for lots and lots of reasons. In this report, there's a focus on the Latino community, which is an extremely obviously important to community, but also in terms of numbers and significance. The Latino youth group is the fastest growing group in this country, but it's also the group whose families are most affected by deportation. Deportation affects all immigrants in this country, but it affects Latinos in very serious and very significant ways by just looking at the numbers of who's being deported. There have been a variety of studies over the last couple of years since these enhanced deportation policies have been in place. And the studies have a lot in common. We've looked at adults, we've looked at children, we've looked at systems in these studies. But what we're finding when we interview immigrants themselves is that they're finding increasingly more difficult to live in this country, to function in this country. They have a fear, a real genuine fear every day of what might happen to them. Everybody knows someone who's been deported. So it is not a concept. It's not something you just read about in the paper. It is part of their lives. And finally, and this is a huge number, I think, as a population in these studies, what we find is over 40% of immigrants feel discriminated against on a daily basis. For many minority groups in the United States, that is the case. The fact that we have over the years looked at immigrants as a contribution to this country, and now what we see is these people feel discriminated against, I think says a lot to us. I do want to move on to the report because it's got so many great findings. But I do want us to look, as we're listening to the report, think through the different aspects of what's happening with policies. Because not only are they affecting school engagement for kids, they're affecting their academic achievement and their future outcomes. And that's the thing I think we have to remember is the future outcomes. They are dealing with a variety of assaults, starting with increased deportation. But also we see policies talked about every day that limits refugee entrance into this country, makes it harder for people to come here to get asylum. Characterizes immigrants as threats to both national security and the economic well-being of this country. This generation is at risk when they see themselves as part of a population that is being described in these ways. I think it's important that as the speakers talk, you listen to all the aspects of these assaults on kids that are taking place, because it's assaults on the individual, but it's also assaults on their families. It's assaults on their future. It is assault on the very system, the school system that takes care of them every day, and an assault on the educators who care about them. So I would like to turn it over right now to Emily Ruskin, who is going to, she's a senior policy analyst at UnidosUS, and she's going to talk to you about the findings of the report. And I look forward to seeing you in a while. I hope you'll have some good questions.
Thank you, Delia. And good morning. I'm Emily Ruskin. I'm a senior policy analyst with UnidosUS, working on immigration policy. And about a year ago, around this time, is when we started looking systematically at the harm to children due to immigration enforcement policies that really laid the foundation on which we're building our research now. It's called Beyond the Border, and I encourage you to check it out on the website. And the report that we're releasing today builds on the Beyond the Border paper, looking at it from the K-12 perspective. And I'm going to get to that in a minute, but I'd like to take a few steps back first, and I think Dahlia really laid the groundwork well for us here. So if I asked you to imagine family separation, you'd probably think of images like this. Images from the southern border, images of detention camps, and what happened and continues to happen to children along our border is tragic. It's irrefutably wrong that we're forcibly separating children from their parents, let alone thousands of children. But what I want to talk about today is a very different face of family separation that Dahlia touched on. It's a crisis that's harming millions of American children. Regardless of the politics of immigration, the facts are that Latino children are critical to our nation's future. They're already one in four American kids. And I apologize, it's a little small. There are already one in four of the children in this country under the age of 18. And in 10 years, they're going to be one in three. And nationwide, they're already making up 25% of all of our nation's public school children. And they're going to be 30% by 2030. So they're our future workers, our future voters, our future leaders, the parents of our future children. And many of you may know this already, but Latino children are overwhelmingly US-born citizens. So yes, most have at least one parent who was born outside of the US, over 50%, and many, an estimated 25%, live with an undocumented parent. Together with the children of DACA and TPS holders, there are roughly 6 million American children at risk of family separation today. More than 4.5 million of them are Latino, and many are in your district or town. So when we come to your offices about appropriations measures, or relief bills, or regulatory affairs, these are the kids that we're thinking of. Our community's children, your district's children. And we're here today because they're under attack. First, I'd like to explain how it is that an entire generation of American children are being impacted by immigration policies and politics. Let's start with the smallest group, which is still 6 million children. The kids who live with at least one undocumented parent. This group lives in constant fear of separation due to detention or deportation. Children like 13-year-old Fatima Avilika, who, while driving to school with her dad, just like she did every day, was pulled over by ICE and had to watch as her father was aggressively arrested. Now, Fatima happened to be a student at Academia Avanza, one of the nearly 300 UnidosUS affiliates that Amalia mentioned earlier, some of which are schools. And so through the tireless efforts of her school community, her neighborhood, her community, including UnidosUS, Fatima's father was released after 6 months and allowed to continue his case in a non-custodial setting. But many parents in similar situations are not. These children may also fear contact with enforcement themselves. And that's also not without reason. But these 6 million kids also have classmates and friends, and they start to wonder if it could happen to them, regardless of their parents' immigration status. They start to wonder if they could be separated too. And they also have classmates who might feel differently, classmates who might see what's happening as an opportunity to bully or to intimidate. And they're not getting these ideas and these words in a vacuum. Which is why studies are showing, as Dahlia mentioned, increasingly, that all Latino children are experiencing harm in the current situation, in the current climate. The fear of separation, the fear of alienation, the fear of bullying, or worse, the fear of violence. And these are the conditions in which we're expecting our children to learn, beyond the normal anxieties of childhood and adolescence and school, or even school violence. Which brings me to our report. So as I mentioned, UnidosUS has been closely studying American children in immigrant homes for more than a year now, so we know what the research tells us. We know that chronic stress, like mentioned in our last slide and as Delia mentioned, is incredibly damaging to child health and development. Likewise, we've also been hearing directly from parents and educators. So it was incredibly validating to see what we already knew anecdotally to be true, studied by researchers at the Civil Rights Project at UCLA. In fact, their paper opens with the story of the Avelica family. The study surveyed 3,600 educators across the US to find out, how is immigration enforcement impacting schools and students in America? The main finding was that regardless of where you are or your immigration status, the hostile environment created by the current US immigration system is hurting American students, all American students. That study inspired our own. So the researchers from UCLA were incredibly kind and they shared their survey tool with us, which we then adapted and used with our own teachers. So we gave the survey last summer with the help of my awesome colleagues in the Ed Programs team during mandatory workshops for educators in the K-12 programs that UnidosUS runs through some of the ones on the side you can see over there. We also opened it up to the NISL fellows. We had a total of 64 folks in the final sample, mostly from the coasts, about 70-something percent, and then the rest was evenly split across the US, mostly Title I schools, high populations of immigrants and immigrant parents, high populations of English learners. And you can find more on the sample and the methodology in the appendix. But what we really wanted to know and what we were really trying to find out is, what are you seeing? What is it like in your classrooms? What is happening to your students? And it ends up, they're observing children in crisis. 92% of the educators surveyed said that they had observed students directly expressing fear of immigration enforcement, primarily ICE. Now think about that for a minute. Remember, 95% of Latino children are US citizens. Remember also that ICE's stated mission is to protect Americans against national security and public safety threats. 92% also said that immigration enforcement has so changed the classroom climate, directly and indirectly, that it's made it hard for all of their students to learn. More than half also said that they've seen an increase in bullying due to the perceived immigration status of the student or the parent. And it's important to keep in mind that the majority of the educators who are in the UnidosUS programs are Latino, and many speak Spanish as one of their primary languages at home. And the research on this issue is very clear, that having a teacher with a shared ethnic or cultural background is hugely beneficial for students. But what our results show is that even in classrooms where children should feel the safest, with teachers who look like them, speak their language, understand where they're coming from, or at the very least can empathize, we still cannot create environments that they need to succeed because of our immigration policies and politics. In fact, what all of these similar studies that Delia mentioned show together is that we cannot create the environment for any students in the US right now, and that's a huge problem. But just because this is our situation now doesn't mean it has to be or will be the situation forever. As she mentioned, we have to remember that we're incredibly fortunate to have this young, diverse population. 15 years from now, America will have more people over the age of 65 than under the age of 18 for the first time ever in our nation's history. And at least one-third of them will be Latino. Research on second-generation Latino children shows that these kids are rich in what is called community cultural capital, youth who are multilingual, optimistic about their futures, even in the face of huge barriers, and rooted in a sense of responsibility to their families and communities. So we're so lucky to have these youth be the future of our nation, but we have to be so careful not to squander the wealth of this diversity on short-sighted, counterproductive immigration policies. We're also lucky that these problems are not intractable. There are concrete steps we can be taking to change things, but we have to take them now or we're going to miss the window of opportunity. In the immediate term, we have to pass an appropriations bill that permanently protects DACA and TPS holders. Together, they have roughly 1 million US-born children. A survey last year of DACA recipients found that those with US-born children think about being separated from their child at least once a day. 20% think about it at least once an hour. We also have to pass an appropriations bill that holds enforcement agencies to account. DHS has record high funding, and since fiscal year 2017, the agency has routinely overspent what it's been given. Worse than that, it then goes around congressional appropriators to usurp funds from other parts of DHS for wasteful, indiscriminate spending that we've seen compounds the harm to children in immigrant families. We have to invest in education spending, especially Title I and English learner programs, and not cut it as the president's budget proposes. We also have to curb regulatory abuses that hurt American children. This administration has ramped up efforts to block low-income, primarily Latino immigrants, from traditional legal pathways into our country. Most famously, the one that you're probably the most familiar with is DHS's public charge rule, which just went into effect. But it's actually part of like a larger basket of policies which have many hateful tentacles. And the research, including our own research, shows that these policies have really harmful spillover effects on US citizen children in immigrant families, especially health and well-being. So we can't be funding policies that allow discrimination in our immigration system or knowingly harm our children. Which is why when we come back at the end of the month with our changemakers, you're probably gonna hear some of these asks again. So my colleague likes to say that UNIDOS has the three Ps: policy, programs, and people. And I hope I've given you a little insight into our policy research and our programs. So now I'm really excited to introduce you to some of our people. Our affiliates and our fellows are the lifeblood of this organization and the pulse of their communities. Marisol Rerucha joins us from San Diego, where she's a longtime educator, activist, and community leader. Today, she's the director of culture and community at Dave Burgess Publishing and serves as a consultant whose clients include local and national nonprofit organizations, public schools, and the private sector. John Monteleone joins us from Cleveland, Ohio, where he's the academic superintendent of Citizens Academy, a breakthrough public school. He also partners with the Ohio Latino Affairs Commission to deliver advocacy trainings across the state to Latino parents on education issues. But before I hand it over to today's panel, we want to share a recent experience from the field. Sandra Peliquin is a current NISL fellow and teacher at Lorain High School in Ohio, one of the northern border cities. Through her work as a teacher of English learners, she has become a pillar of Lorain's longstanding Latino community. So I'll hand it very briefly over to Sandra before turning back to Dahlia and our panel for what I know is going to be a great conversation. Thank you, here's Sandra.
Good morning. I am an EL teacher in Lorain, which is an urban area only about 35 minutes outside of Cleveland, Ohio. And I think that's important to know about my story here. And I'm here to share with you what happened in my district last week. A mom from Honduras was a passenger in a car that was pulled over for a traffic violation, which led to the Border Patrol being called to come and pick up the mom. These two agents gave the mom the option, the agents, to go to detention alone or go to the elementary school and pick up her 9-year-old daughter. The mother had nobody to represent her or counsel about her options for her daughter. She was brought into the school by the agents sobbing uncontrollably because she knew she was going into detention and to be deported. The little girl's teacher was called to bring her down, had no idea why, and was brought into the office in this horrible scene. Then the student, of course, was sobbing, seeing her mom sobbing, and she had to say goodbye to her teachers. I don't need to tell you how stunned the staff was. Meanwhile, the teacher had become close to the mother through the school year, as the mom was very involved in her daughter's education, and the mother had shared just a small part of the horrors she had suffered in Honduras. I cannot share them because the teacher could not bring herself to repeat them. And the teacher currently now says she's grieving over the loss of the mother and daughter, and it's worse than a grieving of a death of a loved one, because she says she'll never know what happens to them, and she knows some of the horrors that is awaiting them. And she'll always worry. Since then, the teacher has listened to other stories from students in the building, because the students are now worried that the police are coming for them, and school no longer is a safe place for them. The teacher finds herself having to counsel and listen to them, and she's had to take on this stress even more. I found out yesterday, because of this incident that occurred, a daycare provider went to one of our schools with papers giving the daycare provider custody of these children if the parents are picked up, because now this is what our parents are now doing, having to do. This is what having Border Patrol in a school building has done to our community up in Ohio. Word has spread quickly through the entire community, and our students and families are stressed and worried. The EL teacher herself is experiencing what I call secondhand trauma. Even before this happened, I firmly believed that many of our students suffer from PTSD, as I've seen it. Some of our students are undocumented themselves, but more than not, more students come from mixed documented families. To have this hanging over your head and having to be hyper aware at all times that you or your family members may be picked up is an extreme stress to carry on your shoulders day after day, year after year. This constant worry, living in fear and anxiety never lets up. They never get a break from the pressure, and all of this has to eventually take a toll on you physically and mentally. And these are children. And I know it does because I've seen it. I know a family who the four children were born here. The mother is documented, the father is not. And it's extremely physically and emotionally stressful on the children. One daughter suffers from a skin condition. The two boys have stomach issues. One has, constant diarrhea. Thank goodness the teachers rally around these children by showing patience and kindness and writing letters on behalf of the families. There's another family where the parents are undocumented. The older sister is DACA, and the youngest was born here. Who knows what will happen if DACA goes away and what will happen to this family. There's a family at our school from Mexico where this past year, the uncle in Mexico was kidnapped. Talk about stress. Many have had a parent or close family member deported. One of my high school students last year always walked slumped and with his head down, but he was working on getting his papers. As soon as he did, totally different child. Walked and carried himself totally different. Graduated and now is a citizen of the United States. Another family, the mother was deported. She had 13 children here, some of who are American citizens. The youngest boy, who has special needs, had such physical reaction to being separated from his mother. Who is a U.S. citizen, he had to go to Mexico to be with his mother. I don't know about you, but when I was a child, there wasn't anybody I needed more in my life than my family. And without that support, I don't know how I would be expected to learn or become a productive citizen. Thank you.
Thank you, Sandra. This is really tough. So I'm going to turn it back over to Delia and John and Marisol for what I think is going to be a great conversation.
I'm going to be very quiet for the next 20 minutes while these folks tell you their stories and give you some real-life examples of what we just talked about in the abstract. So let's start with John.
Sure. So I'm John Monteleone. I'm academic superintendent, as you've seen, in Cleveland, Ohio. And I think it's really important to note that I spent 5 years as the principal of the building that this occurrence happened, that Sandra just spoke about. So I was able to spend 5 years living this reality of these families and dealing with their trauma on a day-to-day basis. I still have memories of Safety Week when we would invite law enforcement into our building and literally having children scream and run to the corners of the room. I still have traumatic thoughts of myself, of students actually looking at the officers and having, I had two students wet themselves just by the sight of an officer coming into to the classroom. And I remember the staff and myself as a principal just dealing with the burden of limited resources and limited supports to deal with the trauma that was happening in our schools. And the limited parent engagement that we had from our families that were immigrants or families that just didn't have that secure feeling of the school, and literally having to take off-site conferences to local church and community centers just so they can see and get the reports of how their the students' progress. So as a systems leader today, I think about that experience as a building principal and having to deal with that as a staff where I hate to use the word, but where the burden was upon us to deal with the trauma and provide the wraparound services. So as a leader now in the system, the importance of recognizing no matter where you are, what district, what community, our children and families deal with trauma. And with that, I took the liberty of making sure that our staff and our community didn't have to deal with that burden alone, that we have external partners, and that we could bring in So one of the first initiatives that I brought to our district in Cleveland, Ohio, was making sure that we had site-based mental health services in each one of our campuses 5 days a week. And that was available to not only our students, but to our families and to our staff. But in going above and beyond that, because that's on the clinical side, sometimes you just need someone in the building that sees something wrong with a teacher or a family member or a student and say, hey, like, it looks like you're having a bad day. Let's talk about this. Let's meet. That's why we have partnered with World Peace Teachings, who does work not only in Northeastern Ohio, but in Boston around social work. And in that way, they're just able to have those impromptu conversations and provide that feedback to students and not only families. I urge, if there's any system leaders in the audience, to look upon that as taking the burden as a central office administrator. I could have easily spent the first year of my tenureship as a superintendent just looking at the data from my office, looking at the statistics, but instead, I was honored and fortunate enough that my board and my CEO supported me having an office in each one of my campuses so that I can live the reality of our teachers, so I can live the reality of our students, and that I can report to them of what's actually happening instead of showing them pie graphs and Excel sheets. So that is what I'm here to talk about today, and I look forward to having this dialogue with all of you.
Thank you. Marisol.
First of all, I'd like to recognize and honor the native land that we are sitting and we stand in of the Ancostan and Nacochanc tribes. I am the granddaughter of immigrants, the daughter of activists, the mother and grandmother of women, and I'm a proud American citizen. I feel betrayed by our country. I feel betrayed by the promise of the Statue of Liberty that reads, give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless tempest tossed, to me. I lift my lap beside the golden door. I feel betrayed by the lie of our country that's built on the back of our people, of their sweat, of their blood, of their bones. In October of 2018, I received a text message at about 1:30 in the morning from the executive director of ACLU. I'm from San Diego, California, and ICE was, CBP was dropping off people. They had decided to no longer support them, and so they were dropping them off with nothing at bus stations. The ACLU in San Diego started the San Diego Rapid Response Network, which, like 911-211, was a number that community members could call if there were any immigration concerns. And so we were activated. And I was part of the triage team, and what I saw was not just Spanish-speaking, but indigenous-speaking fathers, sons, mothers, and daughters who have come. They were right before the big migrant caravan that was coming from South America. It broke my heart to see our men with ankle bracelets, whose biggest concern was making sure that they had connection so that they could keep that ankle bracelet charged. All they had, one of the images that will always stay with me, is every single person that we interviewed, they had the clothes on their back and they had a crumpled sheet of paper with one name and one phone number of somebody here in the United States. And our support was to help them get, sometimes from San Diego all the way to New York, on the bus. These people did not read and write in English or Spanish. And so trying to be able to support them on how to make those transfers on the bus. Some of them have families that could help pay for an airline ticket. So had no experience, we were able to provide the support to get them through the airport. One story that stayed with me, I was talking to the mother and her daughter was hanging on to her. Her daughter was 11 years old. And the mother told me that when they went into immigration, they separated them, and her daughter started crying uncontrollably because of the fear of being separated from her mother. And this was right before we got all of those stories of the separations and what was happening. My fear is not just that we're talking about a generation at risk, we're talking about generations. Our Indigenous teachings tell us that we need to not just work and be concerned of our generation and that coming after us, but seven generations. What we are doing now will impact up to seven generations. When I look at my granddaughter, I don't just see that next generation, I see a future ancestor. And sitting here as future ancestors, we have a moral responsibility and an obligation beyond the borders of our country as human beings. I've done work in the juvenile justice field, and the impact of intergenerational trauma that continues to happen and the criminalization of our people, students being released because of and getting caught into that cycle of recidivism, and then being released and having nobody to come home to because their families were deported. If not us, then who? And where else but in schools? We have a moral responsibility and an obligation to provide healing. I love my kids, and I love my granddaughter, and what I know is that if you do your work, and you take care of your family, and you take care of your children, the world's going to be a better place for them. And we have to reach our hands out to each other as brothers and sisters, and aunties and uncles, and tías and tíos. Today we had the beautiful privilege of seeing a group of predominantly African-American students right in front of the hotel talking about, they were cheering for immigration reform. And this group, the group in the back, I ran outside to videotape them, and they were middle schoolers. You can hear it in the video, their deeper voices saying, love your neighbor, love your neighbor. I'm not sorry. Because this is real, and this is my heart. And really, this, I think through this connection, this authenticity, this vulnerability, this plead for our people. And our people is not determined by the color of our skin or by our citizen status, but by the fact that we are human beings. And now we'll go to Q&A.
Thank you, Marisol. Thank you, John. You both gave us incredible stories of your particular reality and what you've done. This is happening in schools across the country because schools across the country serve immigrants. Huge numbers of schools, a huge proportion of schools has at least one immigrant child. So this is not an isolated experience. So as you think through how systems can change and how teachers have had to change, can you talk a little bit about what has to happen to support the system and the teacher to be able to do what Marisol asked us to do?
I know that it starts with the leaders of that district. As a leader, you know, you're often, it's one of our tenets to comfort those that are experiencing discomfort, but also those that are comfortable, make them a little uncomfortable. And I think even though some district leaders or board members don't want to have the conversation that we're having today, I think, like Madi said, it's my moral and ethical obligation to put them non-judgmentally in spaces where we're having these conversations. And then I think it's really showing them what is actually happening and how this is impacting students. And for the most part, I have to say upon my experience and even my experience in Cleveland, it wasn't convincing the educators or the building leaders about these traumatic experiences that were happening and why we needed these wraparound supports and why we needed to create parent resource rooms, safe parent spaces. It was really convincing the board because oftentimes they just don't understand the why. And I think having that conversation is the first conversation that you want to have.
I think the conversation is important and the expectation. Cultural relevant communities, culturally relevant learning, culturally relevant teaching, the understanding of that, I think that is a tremendous step forward. In one of my roles that I have, I talk to predominantly white authors about their implicit bias and how it's showing up. We are not having those conversations. I think having real conversations about race and equity within the systems and not just having somebody in that position, which is usually a person of color in that position, but really starting to raise that expectation of reflection and ownership that can then open the door for healing. It's not just our students, but it's also our staff that are in a lot of pain. And as Sandra talked about, that are really suffering from not just secondary trauma, but from primary trauma, because these incidences are now happening in the schools. And so having access, as John has provided for his community, but culturally competent mental health, culturally competent teaching and learning environments is really one of the things that we need to start insisting that happens nationally across our systems. And I think this work, what Unidos has done with the National Institute for Latino School Leaders, of showing us how to become advocates, extending that work out so that community members can hold their systems responsible.
I would love to ask you more questions, but there's a whole audience here, and I know we're short on time. So I'm going to ask them one more question, and you be thinking of what you want to ask, and I'll call on you in a minute. The question I want to ask is sort of technical. You know, one of the rages we go through trends in education, one of them right now is social-emotional learning. Mm-hmm. And you see curriculum that talk about social-emotional learning, and it has nothing to do with the real lives of children. Are there ways we can take these trends and use them to the benefit of the realities of children's lives? And how do you do that?
So I really believe in strategy. I believe in being very clear about what the mission and vision and your belief statements are and your expectations are of any organization, because those founding documents, also having agreements on how it is that you interact, those founding documents, that founding work, is what really drives the organization. So I think these things being seen on a one-off, that's one of the mistakes that we have in education, is we're so comfortable talking about the pendulum and not bringing in alignment all of these initiatives and why it is that they're good for kids. And so social emotional learning, I think if we take it out of the context and start to really make the connections about why this is important, not just for students in schools, but for their families and for teachers, like making those clear connections, extending beyond the classroom, that really going into the community work. One of the beautiful things, I think, like the WASC accreditation process, is they talk about it's not just a new thing. How are you very clearly making connections between all of these initiatives? But I think this is really, really important and shouldn't just be that hot topic item. As a country, because of the changes that have been happening, I think people are just more open to reflection and healing. And so I think this is now the time to really jump on this issue and not just make it the hot topic in the moment.
And so I appreciate the question. It's a great question. And from a practitioner, and I mentioned, I didn't get a lot of pushback from leaders and teachers, but one of the questions was, to me, as a superintendent, was like, John, when are we going to have the time for the social-emotional curriculum? Teachers already live in a pressure cooker as it is. And that was the fortunate part about me being in the campuses and seeing what tools they were using, the curriculum that they were using, and looking and examining at their daily schedule. And a lot of what I saw in my first year was students that, and we're talking K-5 buildings, that literally lived in a state of like midterms because we were assessing them month after month after month using different diagnostic tools and different benchmarks. So one of the first things that I was able to do to not only free up time but also allocate money was just rip away assessment tools. Because at the time, we didn't have a comprehensive assessment plan. Teachers were using assessment tools and didn't know the why and purpose behind it. And then building in intervention blocks into our daily schedules where we can have that social emotional learning time, where we can have social workers work with our students. And the really eye-opening moment for our board and our staff was, listen, you're asking students to access curriculum that they can't mentally access if we don't treat the root cause of what is going on with them inside of their head and the trauma that they're dealing with. Not only then will they be able to access what you're trying to teach them throughout the day. And it really was just an educational piece, not only from myself, but from our external partners that we had coming in and helping us in building that capacity, building that knowledge, building that why. Great question. Thank you.
Questions from our audience? Yes.
The sensitive locations memo that prohibits ICE and other officials from entering schools, churches, hospitals, it seems like they're just violating that.
There might be someone here who has more technical knowledge, but as I understand the sensitive locations memo, it can be overridden. And I think what happens is there are levels of things that happen. One, communities are not aware of these memos. And the sensitive locations memo, for most of you know, but it outlines places in the community where ICE is not supposed to go in to carry out enforcement strategies without permission from above and all that. So a lot of times community members don't know that those memos exist. Educators don't know that those exist. I know your organization and others has made an effort to get information out to building administrators, to superintendents, to school boards. The school boards association sent out information saying, here's what happens when there's an enforcement raid in your community. Here are your rights as an administrator. Here's what can happen in schools. Here's what shouldn't happen in schools. But that's still not out to everybody. It's not out to communities, and often there's peer pressure in the community, political pressure to do some of these things. And so we still have a lot of advocacy work to do. So yes, the memo exists. It does have some limitations, but the biggest limitation right now is lack of knowledge about it and lack of advocacy around its enforcement.
Thank you. I would say also a lot of schools have districts, and I venture to say probably all of them have some policy around what to do when law enforcement arrives. But what I have found is that staff is not being trained on what that policy is. And so I think the natural thing is when a police officer arrives or any kind of law enforcement that you give them access to information. So I think really like a push out around information around and a training of front office staff, of administrators, of what the law is critical.
Other questions? While you're thinking of one, I have one, another one. MPI, my organization, is going to release a report in April that actually interviews high school students and has administered levels of depression instrument with them, and the findings are going to be very interesting. So what we will find is that there's a high level of depression among immigrant students for all the reasons we've talked about today. In addition to the resources that you've talked about, John, and you were able to get as an active and thoughtful school leader, we need resources for our teachers, and we need a mindset in our teachers. What can we do to start preparing teachers in a different way through the system? Many of them are natural advocates and have prepared themselves. We have heard in past raids of teachers who took kids home because their parents were gone. So teachers want to help, but a lot of them don't know what to do and have not had that support or training. What can we do to change that? What can we take advantage of? What are supports for us doing this within the system?
So I'm again speaking from a practical practitioner level. One of the things that I do alongside one of our UnidosUS affiliates, El Central Social Services in Lorain, and the director and president, Victor Leandri, is we recognize exactly everything that you said. And fortunately for us, we have connections within our community and professors that have teacher prep classes at local community colleges. Bowling Green University is one. And in the spring, around this time, is we actually visit those classrooms and we talk about these topics right here. Having gone through the traditional teacher prep program, I can tell you firsthand, we don't get this training. We don't get this knowledge. And so having that opportunity and having these innovative professors allow us to come into those spaces and talk to these young upcoming teachers about exactly what they're going to experience and exactly what to look for when they apply for districts that they want to work in. And that is what's really important for me as a superintendent is when I'm speaking to them is I know you're young, I know you want to get a job, but it's very important for you to be interviewing the district to know what supports are there for you as a young teacher, just as much as they are interviewing you. And then along with those teachers that are young teachers and already in the environment is just working with those external partners like we have in Cleveland and giving them job-embedded professional development. That was one of the reasons why I pushed so hard to have those site-based mental health experts in the buildings 5 days a week so they can have that job-embedded time with those teachers and build that capacity and look at our PD schedule and make sure that they were providing sessions throughout the year, month after month after month.
Yeah, I would add ways to be able to really support teachers with dealing with the trauma and also their own depression around these issues. We talk about restorative practices, which is really a centuries-old practice of dialogue in circles that every single one of our ancestors have used, you know, like Stonehenge is in a circle for a reason. But the idea of being able to have that time and that connection, so engaging in restorative practices with staff is also really critical. So providing space for healing, conversation, and connection with the adults and with your community and your parents is really, really critical. And I think what we haven't talked about also is that engagement piece. Like how are we supporting teachers in being very conscious about engaging parents who may also have these fears, who may not have citizenship, and welcoming them and inviting them into school.
You've both talked about what we can do for children when they're in trauma, when they are faced with situations, how you can support them. How do you, and I think about this in the context of the appropriations bill that we're talking about, all the hooks in there, how do you develop resilience in children before something happens? How do we help these children become resilient in the face of something that might happen? What can we use that's at our disposal so that not only can we comfort them after they happen, but they can do some self-soothing and comforting themselves?
I think, so for me, my perspective, the key has to be providing that healing community. So again, you have a healing school community where you're taking care of your staff, where staff feel home and are not acting and living through their pain with kids, then that creates that space for them to feel safe. And not just safe, but we also want to create that brave space for kids, right? And for our staff, where they can start to push and question in really thoughtful ways. So I am a proponent of restorative practices, but not just as a practice, because for me, it's not just something that you do, it is who you are, and it is a way that you walk in the world. So restorative means, you know, do you carry that mindset and that heart set that we are human beings, and it allows for that time and that space for connection. And so really it has to be the way that you, as either a school leader or the leader in your classroom or the leader of your team, how are you creating the culture in that space? because then you can provide that for your students to come in. But we have to take care of our adults as well as the kids.
I'm going to push you a little because I agree with all those things. Mm-hmm. But I wonder what the role of academics in this. When a child is accomplished and can do things that he didn't think he could ever do, I think that child has a different sense of authority, a different sense of agency. How do we use our Title I funds? How do we use all those hooks and appropriations to build kids' esteem through their own accomplishments so that when something happens, they know there's still somebody? And I wonder how we think of that as a community. I think the socio-emotional pushes are really important, but I wonder how we use everything at our disposal as educators to be able to build that resilience in children.
Well, I just want to talk
about that. No, go.
But I appreciate that because then I go through like cultural responsive, access to culturally responsive curriculum. Students need to see themselves and see a diversity of people who have been successful and be able to read those stories, touch those stories, have people brought into classrooms that are successful that they can connect with. And I agree with you, it is about ultimately building that success. But you have to make sure that students and staff are cared for and that they can delve into those waters of the academics in a confident way. So culturally responsive curriculums, materials, access to a diversity of stories, reading, writing, numeracy, bringing in different ways of math, different ways that countries, like those things are really important.
Yeah, I'm just going to echo what Madi said. When I hear you speak and I hear you push back, it just takes me to really developing a healthy organization. Mm-hmm. Which takes time. And even with all the work that we're doing currently in our district, you know, we're not near where we need to be because making sure that staff feel safe and parents feel safe and students feel safe, that is hard work. And I often think whether you're in public education or you're in the private sector and you go into an organization and then it lacks that healthiness, it's because it's hard work, and a lot of leaders don't want to take the time and effort to do it. And I don't think it's because they think it's beneath them, but a lot of our leaders are super intelligent, and they may not be supported by those that they answer to. And analytical work to them is a lot easier than building that organizational health, but you can't get to where you want to go in everything that you're mentioning if you don't build that healthy organization first.
I have one more question, but I'm willing to cede my time if anybody has a question from the audience. Yes. They're discussing.
Yes. Great question, by the way, and just very relevant. Again, it comes back to the educational piece, especially when it comes around the time. As a leader, you have to allow your staff to take risks. They know their students the best. They know when it's time to transition into math or maybe when it's time to transition into more SEL learning. Maybe it's time to have a restorative practice. But back to your point about culturally relevant teachings, the staff needs to understand that each one of us brings a gift and a talent and schema to the classroom. And we have to incorporate that into our instruction because our minds will latch onto that if we have something that is relevant to us. And it's expressing that and giving them time and the resources to incorporate that into their teachings. And then I think it's important, and again, I'm gonna come back to the board members and I'm gonna come back to people like myself as a superintendent. You as a community have to sit down and establish what is your vision or what is your profile for a learner? Is it that do you want to measure your learners up against the scoreboard that the state puts out in their annual report card? Or do you want to graduate and produce functional members, healthy members of society that had a great experience at school? I know ESSA is not the cure-all, but I still see us living the trauma as educators from the consequences of No Child Left Behind, and it's really just getting beyond that mindset.
I appreciate your question, and I love learning, so that culturally sustaining, yes. Thank you for that. I think, so, you know, Delia was talking about funding, right? So like our Title I, Title II, Title III funding, how are we using that for professional development? Do people know what we mean when we talk about culturally sustaining curriculum and practices? And so, and I'm a big fan of Zarita Hammond, so how do we get beyond the surface level, right? Beyond shallow into the deep. How are we talking and thinking about with our teachers about race? How are we thinking and talking about how our culture impacts our learning in the classroom, and how do we provide opportunities specifically for our Black and Brown students to engage in learning in a way that is more culturally sensitive and relevant and powerful for them? So I really think using those title funds to be able to provide the professional development from people with expertise that can explain what all of what we mean when we start talking about those things. And then also, again, a part of a healthy organization is providing people for that opportunity, that reflection, that growth and learning time. So really taking that opportunity to start talking about our culture and what cultures is it that's represented in our current American curriculum. What culture is that? What culture is, you know, those are important discussions that we need to have. There is a great book that I had recommended. I have no nuts, but it's a great book. It's about dignity through a culture of belonging by Dr. Floyd Cobb and John Crownapple. Really phenomenal book. It just came out a couple of months ago. But I think they're really also talking about how to do this work with staff to start having those conversations.
And I just want to say, I don't want to send the message that state standards aren't important and that keeping summative assessments shouldn't be on the forefront of your mind. Those assessments give us great data. They tell us where our children are in their educational journey and how they compare to their peers and what we need to do to get them college and career ready. What I am saying is that education is not finite. And if you go into it within a finite mindset that you just want to move the needle, and if whatever that needle may be, then that's where you're gonna lose your students. What we do is infinite, and we have to think it's beyond us, and it's beyond us here in this space and how it's gonna continue going forward.
Yes.
Thank you both. I want to remind you that the report is released today. You have a hard copy, I believe, in your folder. If you'll go to, Molly, are you going to give them the website again, where to go to get the report? And I hope you'll share it widely. It's an important report. Thank you so much for your attention. I'm going to turn it back to Molly.
Thank you so much. I just want to close out the briefing and leave you with an excerpt from our report, which says, "It is entirely probable that the harms we observe now are the early warning signs of eventual cumulative intergenerational effects that will influence our country for decades to come." And as Marisol so eloquently shared with us, we're actually talking about more generations and hundreds of years to come. Overhauling our immigration system may seem an insurmountable task. However, it is in such political twilights that we have historically been our best, our boldest, and our most inventive. We hope you take away from this briefing a story that moved you, a piece of critical data, a renewed energy to stand in solidarity with our immigrant communities. You have in your packets a copy of the report, a new fact sheet on Latino students and English learners, and other resources. And as I mentioned, Progress Report is our blog where you can find many resources as well as the electronic copy of the report that we're releasing today. At the end of this month, Unidos will be having its big fly-in day where we expect over 200 folks, many of them are affiliates and school leaders, who will be walking the halls of Congress, meeting with members, and elevating their experiences from their communities. I want to just thank you all for being with us today. I want to thank our moderator and panelists, everyone on the UnidosUS and Penn Hill teams who had a hand in bringing this event together, and all of you for being such an engaging and captive audience. And with that, we conclude our briefing, and I just want to give a hand to our amazing panel. Thank you so much.